Okay, question one on the FP2 June 2010. First part is just show that. Okay, so we're gonna do FR plus one. What's FR plus one gonna be? Should we work that out? Just one squared. Should I multiply that out or should I leave it like that? Leave it like that. So now we're going to do FR plus 1 and we're going to take away FR. So that's going to be R times R plus 1 squared and then we're going to take away R minus 1 and that's going to be R squared there. Okay, next step. Multiply it out now. Okay, so what do I get? I get R times R squared plus 2R plus 1, yeah? Mm-hmm. Then I've got minus R cubed minus R squared. Yeah, and do I multiply all this out by R as well? So I'm going to get R cubed plus 2R squared plus R. Then I've got minus R cubed plus R squared. Okay. Yeah. Right, the R cubes are going to go, aren't they? So we've got 3R squared plus R. Is that it? Yeah, and then take out a factor of R. 3R plus 1, and that's what we're trying to show, isn't it? Yeah? Okay, cool. Okay. So that's part A done. And then it says, use the method of differences to find the value of this. So let's do that. We're trying to find the value of some... yeah, be careful. It's R starts at 50. R, 3R plus 1. Okay, so the method of differences relies on you writing that... summation out as a difference of two summations. So we're going to write it as 99 plus 50. FR plus 1. I'm just going to write it like this. This is quite an easy one because it lets you write it out as the just the functions, you know. So I'm just going. Do you agree with that? Those are the same thing. Okay, so now I'm going to start writing out the values of R. So I'm going to start R equals 50. I have to do at least 3, remember, okay? So when R equals 50, what I get is F of 51 minus F of 50. Do you agree with that? Okay, when R equals 51, I get F of 52. Minus F of 51, and when R equals 52, I get F of 53 minus F of 52. Is that okay? Mm-hmm. Okay, and then finally, I'll skip a few, and then I'm going to say when R equals 99, because that's the last one, I'm going to get F of 100 minus F of 99, yeah? Do you agree with that? Okay, so then I have a look at how they cancel. So I've got a 51 that's going to cancel with that, because I'm taking away 51 there. That's going to cancel with that. And they're going to cancel all the way down, like that. So I can say then that from R equals 50 to 99 of R... 3R plus 1 is just going to be F of 100, because that's not going to get cancelled with anything. Take away F of 50, because that never got cancelled with anything either. Does that make sense? Yeah? Okay, and now I just put in F of 100 and F of 50. So I go back to the original equation, and that means that this is 100 minus 1 times 100 squared, 50, which is 50 Sorry? 800 and... 800... 500. Very good. What do you think of that question? Okay. So, we've got this cubic. Now, just before we get to the question, because it's going to help us out a little bit later, the cubic, we don't know what it looks like, but a cubic has to have at least one real root, so it could be doing something like that, where it's got one real root. And if all of the coefficients in the cubic expression are real, then the other two roots are complex, and they're the complex conjugate of each other. Okay, so that's going to help us answer. Answer one of the other questions. So I'll just get rid of this, and then we'll go through the part. So the first question is find the value of alpha, beta. So alpha, beta, and gamma are the roots, and it says can you find the values of alpha, beta, plus beta, gamma, plus gamma, alpha. Right. Now we should know what that is. Anybody? Yeah, it's just 6. Well, it's 6 over the coefficient of the z cube, which is 1, so it's 6. Yep. Okay, given that p and q are real, so this is what I was just saying, so if p and q are real, and also that alpha squared plus beta squared plus gamma squared equals negative 12, explain why the cubic equation has two non-real roots and one real root. So how do we go about this then?
Next one is not the
root. Okay, so we've got the three roots, alpha, beta and gamma, and we've squared them and added them, and we've got a negative. So that must mean that at least one of them is complex. Yep. Okay? So when we squared it, we've got a negative. Yeah, Bill. So because all the numbers are real, we've got one... And we know that at least one of the roots is complex, then one of the other roots must be the complex conjugate of the other one. So two of them have got to be complex, and one's the complex conjugate of the other. Okay, does that make sense? So what should we write down then? Let's write it down like this, shall we? Since this is true, alpha squared plus beta squared plus gamma squared, then alpha, beta, or gamma must be complex. Okay, so I think that's your first mark. Since all the coefficients are real, then there must be two complex roots which are the conjugate of each other. Who else did that question there? How do I find the value of P? Anybody? So you're definitely right about that. Alpha plus beta plus gamma is that's minus P, isn't it? So how do I get from there?
could use the version of that square.
So I could square this, I think you're right, yeah? I square the whole thing, yeah? That's going to give me p squared, isn't it?
Yeah.
Okay, and that's going to give me... What do I get if I square the whole thing? Plus what, sorry, Vlad? Three times, isn't it two times, Vlad?
I'm not sure if it's two times.
It should be two. Yeah. Alpha, beta plus... Alpha gamma plus, what, which one have I missed? Beta gamma. Right, is that true? Pretty sure, yeah. Now, we already know that this part, alpha squared plus beta squared plus gamma squared is negative 12, isn't it? And we also know that alpha beta plus alpha gamma plus beta gamma is... 6, is that right? So this is plus 12. Okay, which is 0, which means that p is 0, right? Is that true? Part C. It says that minus 1 plus 3i is a root. Right, find the other two roots, guys. Yeah, so shall we say, guys, if that's one of the roots, what's another root? Yeah, so let's say that's alpha, doesn't really matter. And so another root is going to be that, do you agree? We'll call that one beta. Okay, and then I've got to find the other root. Well, we know that alpha... we found out what p is, didn't we?
Yeah.
So we know that alpha plus beta plus gamma equals 0. So we know that minus 1 plus 3i plus minus 1. Oh, why have I put plus minus 1? It's so weird. Minus 1 minus 3i plus gamma equals 0. So I've got minus 2 plus gamma equals 0. Gamma equals... What the hell happened there? I've done it again. What?
You write gamma from
I don't know. I can't seem to write it at all at the minute. Oh, what the hell? I think it's because I'm bending down. It's not going to ever look right now. I'm going to do it like that. Okay. Sure. That's 2, though, yeah? Okay. So gamma equals 2. And then find the value of Q. How do I find the value of Q now? Yeah, just multiply all the roots. So for part C, I should get that alpha, beta, gamma is equal to Q, isn't it? Minus Q, isn't it? Okay, so if I multiply them all together, I'll get, let's have a look, 2 times negative 1 plus 3i times negative 1 minus 3i. Now let's multiply these out. What am I going to get? I'm going to get 2 times 1. And then what's this? Is that just plus 3? Yeah? Is everyone happy with that? She's 20. So the Q's 20. So we've got to find the angle theta that makes this true using de Moivre. Well, there's two ways of doing it, okay? And they're both pretty straightforward. So the first way is the way that I did it, which is to say that cos theta plus I sine theta, let's put an R in front of that, can be rewritten as R E to the minus I theta. Is that true? Okay. So, have you, that's in your formula book, isn't it? Oh, it's not negative, is it? I'll do that again. Right. Cool. So, yeah, we're trying to find the smallest angle theta that satisfies that. And the one thing we can use is this identity, I sine theta, can be written in this exponential form, like that, and you get that in the formula book. R in this case is 1, so what we get is, let's change it back, theta plus theta to the power of 15 should be equal to e to the 15 I theta. And we want it to equal minus 1. Is that true? Minus I, sorry, yeah. Okay. Now, the way I thought was, if you draw this on an Argand diagram, then negative I is down here, and that means that this angle here is 3 pi over 2, isn't it? Okay. And that must also equal, looking at this exponential form here, 15 theta. Okay? Because those triangles are going to be the same. And so we can just say that 15 theta equals 3 pi over 2. So theta equals 3 pi over 30. So theta equals pi over 10. Okay, so the other way of doing it is like this. So again, I'll write out the thing we're trying to show. So hopefully we'll get the same answer both ways. So I've got cos theta plus I sine theta to power 15 equals minus I again. Okay, and de Moivre says that cos 15 theta plus I sine 15 theta equals minus I. Okay, that's what de Moivre says. Again, it's in the formula book. Now, if you look at what I've got here, I've got a complex number on the left with a real part and imaginary part. And just an imaginary thing on the right. So I'll equate the two things. And so all I need to equate really is I sine 15 theta is equal to negative I, because the cos bit can't ever be complex. Now the divide through by the I's, I just get that sine 15 theta equals negative 1, and just solve this and find the smallest value. So this is just like solving C2 trig equation, isn't it? So what should we do? Should we say well, hold on a second, let's solve sine u equals negative 1. So u is going to be, we want the smallest positive, so you're right, it's negative, it is negative half pi. It's going to be 3 pi over 2, isn't it? So u equals 3 pi over 2. But remember, 15 u is 15 theta. So we get the same equation that we had doing it the other way. And again, pi over 10. Okay, so we're given y equals, well, we're given the expression x times tan to the minus 1x, and we want to differentiate that. So this is going to be the product rule. So it's going to be, the differentiation of this is going to be the differentiation of x, which is just 1, times tan to the minus 1, x, plus x times the differentiation of tan to the minus 1x, and you can look that up in the formula book, and it's 1 over 1 plus x squared. Okay, so that's just part A, 2 marks. Part B wants you to integrate between 1 and 0, tan to the minus 1 of x with respect to dx. So we can see from the previous question that this is going to be x tan to the minus 1 x between 1 and 0 minus the integration of x over 1 plus x squared dx between 1 and 0. Because if I integrate this and this, I should get this. So the integration of this should be this, take away the integration of that. Okay, which is what we're saying. Okay, so this is going to be x tan to the minus 1 of x between 1 and 0. And then the integration of this one here, you notice the top is almost the same as the almost the differentiation of the bottom. In fact, it's just half of it. So this is going to be minus 1 half ln the bottom. Okay, so now I'm just going to sub the 1 and the 0 in. So what I should get is 1 tan to the minus 1 of 1. Take away 0. That's from the first bracket. And then I'm going to minus 1 half ln 2 minus 1 half ln, and I sub 0 and I get ln 1. Okay, and again, ln 1 is 0, so this all just goes to tan to the minus 1 of 1 plus, sorry, minus 1 half ln 2. Okay, so tan to the, inverse tan of 1 should just give me pi over 4. And this here is ln, I'm going to take the half up as a power, so it's root 2, and that's what we're trying to show. Okay, so this is question 5, which is an Argand diagram, and we've got two complex numbers, z1 and z2, at points A and B on the Argand diagram. It says explain why z2, which is this one over here, explain why z2 is equal to z1 when it's been multiplied by I. Okay, so this one's just a little explanation, and all we need to write for that is that when you multiply complex numbers, then you multiply their magnitudes together. So you multiply their magnitudes and sum their I has a magnitude of, sounds like chaff. I has a magnitude.
I have a magnitude of
a one. So the magnitude, oh, what happened there? So the magnitude, still like that, magnitude of Z1 doesn't change. And I has an argument. Of 90 degrees. So the argument of Z1 will increase by 90 degrees. We're given a locus L1 and it says it satisfies Z minus C2 modded. So that's of a point Z away from Z2, and it says that the distance of a point Z away from Z2 is the same as the distance of the point Z away from Z1. Okay, and we want to illustrate that on the diagram. So we're saying that the distance from of a point from Z1 is the same as the distance away from a point of a point from Z2. So that's going to be the perpendicular bisector of these lines. And I draw a line which is 90 degrees to that perpendicular. So it should be something like that. I don't know. Something like that. And carry on down here. Okay, so that's the locus L1. So it's the perpendicular bisector of the points Z1 and Z2. And then the other locus we have, L2, is all of the points which satisfy arg, the argument of Z minus C2 is equal to the argument of C1. So this is saying that the angle which the which a point Z take away Z2 is the same as the angle for Z1. So what we're going to do is what we're saying is if I have a point Z, let's mark it on here, Z, so Z is one of these points that satisfies the this the conditions of this locus, and I take away Z2, so that's me taking away Z2. I want to end up on this line here, Z1, which has this argument here. Okay, so we should see
that the locus is going to be any point along this line here, which is perpendicular to O to A. Okay, because any point on this line here, if I take away Z2 from any point on this line, I end up on the line O to A, which has the same argument as Z1. Okay, so I'm drawing a line from B, which is perpendicular to O to A, for the second locus. Now for part C, it says find in terms of Z1 the complex number representing the point of intersection of L1 and L2. So let's just kind of have a look back at the sketch we've drawn. We want to know this point here where they intersect. Okay. Well, we can do it geometrically because we know we've already shown that this here is a right angle. So this line here, the yellow line, L1, let's just mark it on here, this is L1. Let's mark it a little bit there. That's L1, and this is L2. Well, L1 must cut through the square. It's going to make a square because we've shown that Z1 and Z2 have the same magnitude. This is a right angle, so they've got the same length. So this here should make a square, okay? Because they all have the same magnitude. L2 is parallel to O to A, so that should make a square there. So this point here, we'll call Z, should be Z2. This is me travelling to Z2. Plus C1, so Z1 plus C2. But it says write it in terms of Z1. Well, we've already shown that Z2 is equal to I times Z1. So Z should equal 1 plus I times Z1. Okay, so that's just showing it geometrically, or using a geometrical argument. But we can also see that the same thing satisfies these equations here. So let Z equal Z1 plus Z2. And if I do that, then L1 becomes Z1 plus Z2, take Z2, and we want it to be equal to Z1 plus Z2 take Z1, and then I'm Z1. So the Z2's cancel on this side, and on this side I get that Z1 and the Z1 cancel. So I get this is just C2 on this side, and this is just IZ1, and yet they do have the same magnitude, so that's fine, because I's just got a magnitude of 1. And then chucking it into L2, we get that the arg of Z1 plus C2, subbing in for Z1 again, take Z2, is equal to the arg of Z1, where we should see that the Z2's cancel here, so we'll get arg Z1 equals arg Z1. Okay, so they're both satisfied. So we've got to show it geometrically, and we can show it by subbing in. Okay, so for question 6, we've got to prove this statement here, first of all. So what we're going to do is just multiply this bit out on the left. So I'm going to get k plus 1 over 2k here, minus k plus 1 over 2k plus 1 squared from the bottom. I'm then going to put these fractions together. So I'm going to multiply the left fraction by k plus 1 squared. So I'm going to get k plus 1 cubed. And that's going to be over 2. Okay, so multiply the top and bottom by k plus 1 squared. That means I get that on the bottom. And I'm going to multiply the right one by 2. Now I can just leave the right one as it is. Over 2k and k plus 1 squared as well. I'll turn these into one fraction. One cubed plus all over k plus 1 squared. Now I can factorise the top. Plus 1 squared and minus 1. On the bottom I still got the same thing. Plus 1 squared. Just going to multiply out this top bit now. I've got k plus 1, and this is going to be k squared plus 2k, and then it's going to be plus 1 minus 1, so I just get that. Still over this, k plus 1 squared, a little further. Now I can take a k out as a factor. I've got k plus 1 still as a factor on the top, and that means the other bit is going to be k plus 2. And on the bottom I've still got the same thing, but now I'm going to start cancelling the top with the bottom, so we can see that the k's are going to cancel, and a k plus 1 is going to cancel with one of these on the bottom as well. So I'm going to get k plus 2 over 2k plus 2. Or 2k, so 2k plus 1. There we go. Okay, and that's what we're trying to prove. So we've done that. Okay, so the next step, it says, can we prove by induction that this statement is true? Let me just write it down. Okay, so we've got to prove by induction that 1 minus 1 over 2 squared multiplied by 1 minus 1 over 3 squared and so on up to 1 minus 1 over n squared is equal to m plus 1 over 2m. So we have to use the method of induction to do this. So the first thing we're going to do is we assume it's true. For n equals k. Okay. So we assume it's true for n equals k. Therefore, 1 minus 1 over 2 squared times 1 minus 1 over 3 squared all the way up to 1 minus 1 over k squared, just change the n for k, should be equal to k plus 1 over 2k. Okay, now we've got that result. So now we show it's true for n equals k plus 1. So this means that 1 minus 1 over 2 squared multiplied by 1 minus 1 over 3 squared, and we keep going to 1 minus 1 over n squared, sorry, k squared, which is what we had in the previous, which is what we've already shown, and then we're going to go to one extra part, one extra k, 1 minus k plus 1 squared there. Okay, so we've already shown, or we've assumed it's true, that 1 minus 1 over 2 squared, so on and so on, all the way up to 1 minus 1 over k squared is equal to k plus 1 over 2k. So this should be the same as k plus 1 over 2k multiplied by 1 minus, because we've just put in this extra factor in here. So times k plus 1 squared there. But if you look at part A, we've already done this multiplication, and that equals k plus 2. Well, we've already proved that k plus 1 over 2k multiplied by 1 minus 1 over k plus 1 squared can be written like this. Okay, so that's in the same form. It's just, I can just clear that up a little bit, and you can see that this is k plus 1 plus 1 over 2k plus 1. So it's got exactly the same form as here, except all the k's are now k plus 1's. I just need to show that when n equals and this should be n over 2 plus 1 or just 3 over. Okay, and this obviously on the left is now 1 quarter. Okay. So it's true for n equals. So on question 7, we're given y equals 4 root x, and we want to find the length of the curve between x equals 0 and x equals 1. So we want to find the arc length. So we're going to use the formula, and it's in the formula book. The arc length, S, is equal to the integration between B and A, square root 1 plus dy dx squared, integrated with respect to x. So what we're going to do is we're going to find out dy dx and then just sub it into the formula. So dy dx is going to be 2 x to the minus a half, which is going to be 2 over root x, and then I'm going to sub it into that formula and sub in the limits, and let's have a look at what we get. So subbing this in, we get that s, we're integrating between 1 and 0, and it's going to be 1 plus dy dx squared, so that's going to be 4 over x now, dx, and what I can do is write the x as x over x, it's 4 over x, dx. And then you can see that we get what we're trying to show. So s equals the integration between 1 and 0, square root of x plus 4 over x, dx. Okay, and that's part A done for 4 marks, which is quite nice. Now, for part B, we're going to take this expression, which is taking the limits off it for a moment, x plus 4 over x, so this is the state we got it into, and we're going to use the substitution that it gives us, use u equals 4 sine squared theta. Okay, now I'm doing the integration, so I'm going to want du d theta as well. So let's just work that out now. And that's going to be, differentiate the whole thing, so I'll get 8 sine squared theta, sorry, 8 sine theta. And then differentiate the sine and I get cosh. Okay, so let's go, sorry, this should be, I don't know what I've done here, that should be an x, and that's dx d theta. So it's a direct substitution, so I can just go and swap the x's in here now. So let's go back over here, so this now becomes square root of 4 sine squared theta plus 4 divided by 4 sine squared theta, and we're going to want to change the dx to d theta, so now I multiply all of this by 8 sine theta cosh theta d theta. Okay. Just to tidy it up, I'm going to use the identity cosh squared theta minus sine sine squared theta equals 1. Again, that's in the formula book. Now, this question involves a lot of identities, all of which are in the formula book, but just there's a lot to get through. So I'm going to use that identity there. So what I can do is come back over here, rewrite this as the square root of 4 sine squared plus 1 over 4 sine squared theta, and then take the 8 out the front, and I've got sine theta cosh theta theta, and then using this identity I can write sine squared plus 1 as cosh squared, so I'll put that in. The 4s are going to cancel, so this is going to go to 8. 4s are going to cancel. The sine squared plus 1 is cosh squared, so this is cosh squared over sine squared, and I've got to multiply it by sine theta cosh theta theta. Square root is going to get rid of the squares, so I've got cosh theta over sine theta times sine theta, well they're going to cancel, times cosh theta theta, so this is all the same as 8, like I say the sines are going to cancel, so it's just going to be cosh squared theta d theta, which is what we wanted to show. So that's the part B done, and that's another 5 marks. So that's where we're up to. Okay, for the final part, we're now trying to integrate what we had before between 1 and 0. So we want to, we're basically trying to show, so this is part C, sorry, this is part B, We're trying to find the arc length. We had an expression for it, which is between 1 and 0 of x plus 4 over x dx. We've just shown that this is the same as integrating between, sorry, it's just the same as 8 cosh squared theta d theta, but the limits will have changed because the limits over here on the left were in terms of x. And what we find is that when we put 1 in, when we go back to the identity we used up here, when x is 1, if I put x is 1 here, well, let's put it in here. This means that sine squared theta equals a quarter, so sine theta equals a half, so therefore theta is going to be sine to the minus 1 of a half. That's what we're going to be putting in there for the upper limit. And then the other one is when sine squared theta equals 0, so that's when the inverse, so theta is the value when sine to the minus 1 of 0. Okay, so those are going to be the new limits. So I come back down here and I change the limits from 1 and 0 in terms of x to sine to the minus 1 of a half as the upper limit and sine to the minus 1 of 0 as the lower limit. Well, sine to the minus 1 of 0 is just 0, so let's just change that straight away to 0. Okay, so that's the integration I'm going to have to do. Now, cosh squared is not going to be nice to integrate, so what I'm going to use are some of the hyperbolic trig identities, and so I'm going to put those here and we'll see where we can get with them. Okay, so the first one we want is that cosh 2 theta, and again this is just in the formula book, is equal to cosh squared theta plus sine squared theta. Okay, so I can write cosh squared as cosh 2 theta minus sine squared theta, but then I've got a sine squared theta to integrate, which doesn't help very much. So I'm going to take this identity here, I'm going to combine it with another identity, which I'm going to write and do again in the formula book, which is the one we've already used, and that's that sine squared theta is equal to cosh squared theta minus 1. So I'm going to use these two identities and combine them to make another identity, which I'm going to write over here, which is that cosh 2 theta is equal to cosh squared theta plus sine squared theta, but I'm going to write the sine squared as cosh squared theta minus 1, so that's going to be 2 cosh squared theta minus 1. Yeah, so that's the identity I'm going to use. So I can take this identity now and write that cosh squared theta, which is what we want to sub in here, is equal to cosh 2 theta plus 1 divided by 2. Okay, so we're going to integrate that instead. So we'll take that thing we're trying to integrate, which was cosh squared theta d theta, and we're integrating between sine to the minus 1 of a half and 0, and we're going to say that that is the same as doing the integration of this. So I can take the 8 and divide it by 2 and make it 4. Still got the same limits. Only now what I've got here is cosh 2 theta plus 1. Okay, and I can integrate this now. So that's what we're going to do. If I integrate this, I keep the 4 outside. If I integrate this, I'm going to get 1 half sine 2 theta plus theta. And these are the limits. Zero, like that. Okay, and now I'm going to have to sub in the sine to the minus 1 over half, so I'm going to use one more identity, because I don't want to sub in sine to the minus 1 over half and have the 2 in front of it there. So I need to another identity to get rid of that. I need another way to write this sine of 2 theta. And again, the formula book comes to the rescue. This can be written like that. So there's another identity that I have to use. So I'm going to write this integration out one more time. And it's going to be 4 1 half times sine 2 theta. Well, I'm going to write that instead as 2 sine theta cos theta plus theta. And then the limits are here, arcsine to half on this. Okay, so now all I have to do is sub all of this in. And if I sub all of this in, this is what I will get. I'm going to get 4 sine to the minus 1 over half cosh times sine to the minus 1 over half plus 4 times the theta, so that's going to be 4 times sine to the minus 1 over half. Take away all the times when I sub 0 in. Well, when I sub 0 in, you should see that I just get 0. So that's what I'm looking at here. Okay. Now, this first bit here is going to go to, well, the sine and the sine to the minus 1 here are going to cancel. So this is just going to be 4 times a half, which is just 2. Cosh sine inverse half plus 4 sine to the minus 1 over half. Okay, so what I've got to do now is try and work out what the value of this is here. Okay, this is how we want this bit here, is how we want it to look. And this bit here, this 2 cosh sine, all of that, should be equal to root 5, we hope. Okay, and then we've got the same identity. Then we've got the same as what the question's asking us for. So let's see what we can do with it. Well, I can write, just come to the side here, using the formula book again, but sine to the minus 1 of a half, using the formula book, I can write that as ln a half plus square root of 1 half squared plus 1, which is ln 1 half plus a half squared is going to be a quarter plus 1, so this is root 5 over 4. And finally, I could, if I wanted to, write that as ln 1 half plus root 5 over 2. I'll just leave it like that. Okay. I've also got the identity for cosh. Cosh theta is e to the theta plus e to the minus theta over 2. So if I'm going to do cosh of sine to the minus 1, therefore I'm going to get e to the ln of 1 half plus root 5 over 2 plus e to the minus ln of, let's write it like this, 1 half plus root 5 over 2, all over 2. So this here, this here is the cosh bit that I'm trying to solve, trying to get a value of root, value for. Well, the e and the lun's are going to cancel, so I just get 1 half plus root 5 over 2, and then here the minus is going to be the reciprocal of the lun here, so this is just going to go to 2 over 1 plus root 5 here, and it's all over 2. Okay, not very nice. This is just 1 plus root 5 over 4 plus 1 over 1 plus root 5. Okay, so let's just tidy this up a bit. So what I'm going to do is cross multiply, so I'm going to get 1 plus root 5 times 1 plus root 5 plus 4 all over 4. So just turn this into one fraction, root 5 there. So on the top I'm going to have, what do we get, 1 plus 2 root 5 plus 5 plus 4 all over 4, 1 plus root 5 there. I'll just tidy up the top. So I've got on the top 10 plus 2 root 5, and on the bottom I've got 4 times 1 plus root 5. I'm going to rationalize the denominator, so now I'm going to times the top by 1 minus root 5, times the bottom by 1 minus root 5. So on the top I'm going to get 10 plus 2 root 5 minus 10 root 5, and then I'm going to get minus 10, and then on the bottom I'm going to get 4 times 1 minus 5. Like that. Expecting that. 4 times 1 minus 5. Okay. So just tidying all this up, the 10s are going to cancel. So on the top I've got minus 8 root 5, and on the bottom I get negative 8. So that all equals root 5. And remember, that there was the cosh of sine to the minus 1 of a half. Okay, so quite a bit of work to get there. Okay, so your calculator will probably get there a little bit quicker.
Hello, this is question 8 of June 10, FP2. And we've got to prove that in z to the 6 minus 4z cubed plus 8 equals 0, that z cubed equals 2 plus or minus 2i. And let's go! So first things first, let's substitute x as z cubed. Just like that. Giving us the beautiful equation of when Kieran learns how to write, x squared minus 4x plus 8 equals 0. Now, using the quadratic formula, we can work out what x equals. So, subbing in, we get 4 plus or minus square root of 4 squared, take away 4 times 8, all over 2, which equals 4 plus or minus square root of minus 16, all over 2. Which is 4 plus or minus 4i over 2, which is 2 plus or minus 2i, which is what we were looking to get. Yay! Part ii. Just neat that out a bit. Hence solve that equation, giving your answers in the form Re to the I theta, where R is greater than 0, and theta is between minus pi and pi. It's less than or equal to pi as well. It's pi and minus pi. To the editing room. Yeah, close enough. Now, so first things first, write the what z cubed is equal to. And now write that in the form of e to the I pi. So we should know from GCSE or AS that a triangle such as that, the angle will be pi over 4, and the hypotenuse will be 2 root 2, so we know that that can be expressed as 2 root 2 e to the plus or minus pi over 4 I. Plus or minus. Kieran, plus or minus. Yes. So, that also equal to... Are you going to put in the 2 pi k? Shouldn't you put that in with the z cubed? You've got z's and stuff, and no, it should be z cubed for that, and it should be 2 root 2. Or do your angle over 3. Yes, pull them. So now we substitute in all the values. Minus 2 pi. And 0 plus or minus. So, if we do that, you get root 2 e to the plus or minus pi over 12 I. Like that, with an I on the end, but ran out of board. Pen. Yes. Well done. So now just write those out properly. As they're individual ones. But actually, no, wait, no, no, forget that, forget that, forget that. Yes, pen. So for B, we have to show that for any real values of k and theta, we'll end it up now. Squared. Yes, that's true. So when we multiply them together, you get z squared minus zk e to the I theta minus z squared k e to the minus I theta plus k squared, because the e to the I theta times e to the minus I theta cancel to make 1. E to the I theta minus e to the minus I theta cosine, 2 cosine, and so we get which is what we were looking to prove in the first place. So that was that done. Just drop the question. We've used that formula there. So now we have to express the equation of z to the 6 minus 4z cubed plus 8 as a product of 3 quadratic factors with real coefficients. Which we've just... well, which we now have to do based upon the last question. Because we have numbers and they're complex conjugates and they are roots of the equation. we just refresh ourselves as to what the roots are. So if we do z minus root 2 e to the pi over 12i times z minus the complex conjugate of that, we get it in the form of z squared minus 2kz cos theta plus k squared. Which is equal to, if you plug that into a calculator, z squared minus 1 plus root 3 z plus 2. And now if we do the same for plus or minus 7 pi over 12. We get z squared minus 2 root 2 z cos 7 pi over 12 plus 2, which is equal to z squared minus 1 minus root 3 z plus 2. And if we do the same again for 9 pi I over 12, I miss the I, and you get z squared minus 2 root 2 z cos 9 pi over 12 plus 2. Which is equal to z squared minus 2z plus 2. And if you times them, if you put those in brackets and times them together, consider equal to z to the 6 minus 4z cubed plus 8. And there you go.